is your name?
My name's Gerard.
Gerard. Is this a business meeting?
Not really, no. I just called Miles up and said, do you want to have lunch? I've just got a new job with the Henley Property Groups, which is a new building company actually from Melbourne. And I've come over here and they're doing very, very well. And I've just started today.
And first day on the job.
First day on the job.
This is a good way to...
It is, yeah, it is.
No, start the way you want to finish.
They've given me all my literature that I've got to come and read, and so I'm going to spend the afternoon studying all that, and then I start tomorrow full time. Yeah.
Right. And Miles, how do you know Miles?
Miles is an old friend of mine that we met years and years ago.
How long have you known Gerard? Many years?
About 17, 18 years.
17, yeah.
It's probably a Coopers that brought us together in the
evening.
Coopers Corner.
Whereabouts?
Up in the Adelaide Hills.
That's right.
The in wine country. Called,
yes, well, it is now. It's Lenswood, which Henschke's have bought some land up there, and they're producing beautiful white wines. It's rather hilly up there, and also very wet, so it's presumably good country for white grapes.
In those 17 years, did you see each other regularly, often, frequently, or is it just a casual?
We've actually
kept in touch.
I'd say we have seen each other quite regularly. Sometimes we don't see each other. We might not see each other for 5 or 6 months and stuff. And we worked together for a couple of years, 2 or 3 years, for a building company. And we've just stayed friends, over the years. Mm.
And what were the sort of things that you felt made the friendship? What was the basis of the friendship?
Ah, this is getting very philosophical.
It's getting very deep, isn't it?
Not necessarily.
no, I suppose Christianity.
Yeah.
That's right, actually, indeed.
Yeah.
Well, I first met Miles. We were going to a church years ago. This is back when I had long hair and we were doing motorcycles and things like that. And Miles ended up at the same church as me, and we just sort of met and we clicked. I thought, he looks like an interesting fellow, so I went over and said hello. And we just, then I lived in the Adelaide Hills, he lived in the Adelaide Hills, and we knew, we were going to a little church up there, and then we knew each other, and then we sort of stopped going to church and sort of did our own thing for a while, and then we sort of met up again, and Miles had a few tragedies in his life, I had a few in mine, and and we've looked after each other, so we've been a really good friendship,
Is it that sort of friendship, if you had a tragedy in your life or a problem, would you ring each other?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah?
Absolutely, yeah. No question about it, yeah. Yep, absolutely.
Can we pick one example just to...
Well, I don't know if Miles wants me to talk about this. There's a really terrible tragedy happened in Miles' life many years ago where, without going into too much detail, there's a situation that happened in Sydney where a number of members of his family were murdered, and some 5 members of the family, and I was around at that time that it was happening. And Miles and his wife took off to Sydney and sort of really looked after the people that were over there and help them through the suffering and the time that they went through. It was a terrible time. And then,
did you feel that you could help?
Look, you can only be a friend to someone. You can only be there for them. You can't take on a person's pain, and all you can do is just be there for them. And Miles has been there for me when I've been through some tough times as well.
It's a friendship that's just based on trust, I suppose. I can tell him things that I know wouldn't get any further than him. And it's very difficult as a bloke to actually pour your heart out. Everybody needs to do that every now and then. And it's good to be able to do that, and to have a bloke friend is good, I suppose. It's only difficult if you sort of think of it as difficult. It's not really difficult. You just got to be, just open to the fact that life ain't easy, and you can't keep bottling it in.
Do you have other friends, other close? I mean,
yes,
I do.
I probably have 3.
You've got one friend, Miles.
Yes, I would consider I have 3 close friends, friends that I see on a very regular basis.
And you trust more importantly.
Oh, absolutely, yes. Yeah. I think trust is really important. It's like a wife, and you trust a wife, and you trust a friend.
Do you have a wife?
I do. Yes. And 3 kids.
Yes.
So that's rather interesting, too.
And your wife is counted amongst your friends?
Oh, very much so, yes. I mean, absolutely, absolutely.
How old are the children?
18, 13, and 11.
You have family?
No, I don't. Not married, and I don't have any children. Never been married.
Right.
So I get my satisfaction children-wise through his kids. I've known them since they were little kids. Mm-hmm. And I guess I'm sort of an uncle to probably 6 families that I know since I've lived in Adelaide, and I really get to enjoy the kids. I've got a bit of an affinity with children. Mm-hmm. And every time I go to Miles' place, they're getting older now, so they're a little bit reticent to rush up to you and climb all over you. But when they were young, they would do that indeed, and it's been great. And they, I suppose they see me as some kind of adopted uncle or something, and just absolutely adorable children, great kids, and mates, they're good mates.
And do you have are you single as a, you know, is that a profession? Is that a decision?
It's not a profession. No, what people ask me is, you know, so you're not married and you've never been married and perhaps you're gay. And I said, no, I'm not gay. And not a gay bone in my body. I simply haven't met anyone. That's all. I just simply, you know, and I figure that, you know, and I've never lived with anyone.
Yeah.
And I guess my attitude towards that is that, you know, if someone's good enough to live with, they're good enough to marry. And, you know, and I just literally, I've had a few girlfriends over the time, and I've just never met anyone that I've actually wanted to marry. I mean, I had a couple of, quite a long, when I first met Miles, I went out with a girl for about 4 years, and it looked like it was going to come together and we were going to get married, and it didn't. And then I spent about 4 years on my own, and then I met somebody else who was a lovely girl also, and that did the same thing. So I've stayed away from it now. And now I figure, you know, good things come to those that wait, and I hope that's true, you know.
Yeah, so you tell me, Miles, the tragedy that Gerard referred to, I don't want to drag it through your emotions again, but it's a pretty unusual thing to happen.
Yes.
These family members, were they close to you?
Very, very close. It was in fact a murder-suicide, where my brother-in-law murdered my wife's sister, who were very close, and their children, three children, and his mother. He murdered before he took his own life. Now, they actually came to see us just prior to doing it, and it was an awful thing. I mean, it was dreadful, obviously, for my wife and her parents. And I don't know their degrees of grief, but if there are, my degree of grief wasn't obviously as much as my sister and my in-laws, who were very, very, very close family. And. And it happened. It's just one of the extraordinary things that you cannot believe that it's happening to you. It's a feeling that's very, very hard to actually speak about with people.
Yes.
And we found, apart from a few people, nobody wants to know you. They're kept well away because it's such...
It's confronting.
Huge, enormous, absolutely enormous. And what do you say to somebody? You know?
Was there any indication that there was a problem?
No, none. Only, I mean, hindsight, I looked at a few things that he had said. They had been with us a week before that, and on what it turned out to be the last holiday, he had actually pre-planned everything. Everything down to very fine detail. He had had letters ready to send to us with explanations. And,
did that make sense?
No, it may make sense to a psychiatrist, because there are a lot of ramblings, and very grandiose ramblings, very ego-driven kind of, I'm taking these people with me because I know it's best. And awfully sad, and if a psychiatrist did read them, he'd obviously read a lot more to it than us. It didn't satisfy us, obviously, in any way, and you go through all those various degrees, and now it's just, you know, why? It actually ended up over money, and we worked out that it's $30,000 a life, you know, the effective import of what happened. So anybody can get together 30 grand for a life, you know, so... And you bring it down to that sort of level, it's madness, but I suppose no more mad than the horrible things that go on around us all the time anyway.
This is a long shot because we're talking about tragedies and things and how people cope. You had some tragic events in your life. You referred to something...
Nothing like what Miles has just described, but I mean, I think everyone goes through pain in their lives and life, and I think sometimes... I guess because I live on my own, and I guess sometimes when the problems hit, you know, I've been able to turn to Miles and say, listen, Miles, and I sit and talk to him and bore him crazy.
What
but
sort of
he's
thing?
Been a good
work,
friend, you know.
Work-related or...?
In this particular case it was, yeah. I had a terrible breakdown of communication with my former employer, and it ended up pretty nasty. I felt anyway that... That my performance in this particular job was nothing short of excellence, and Miles can testify to that because he worked with me for 3 years. Mm-hmm. He's written me a lovely reference. Mm-hmm. And out of 106 clients that I had, I've got 96 references. And but the boss didn't see it that way, you see. And I just felt like I wasn't getting paid the money that I was owed. And there were certain things that happened, and there was just a complete breakdown of communication. So we just had a parting of the ways.
Yes.
But it was a trauma for me because I felt like I'd been persecuted.
Yes.
But now that's all over. I mean, that's a couple of years ago, and I've done all sorts of interesting things in the last couple of years. I've read, you know, 100 odd books, and you know, had a nice rest.
I noticed you finished your beer, and you haven't.
I talk more than he does.
Nice to meet you.
And you
yes,
too.
Lovely. Yeah.
It's a story of friendship that will presumably go on. unimpeded. And
well, we reckon it's going to go on to eternity.
To eternity.
Yeah, that's an interesting concept, isn't it?
In that heavenly pub.
A heavenly pub in the sky. That's right. We're sitting here. That's right.
See you there.
You will.
I hope so.
That's
right.
Good luck. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too.
Ordinary chicken?
Am I an ordinary chicken?
Yeah.
I suppose chickens come into two categories.
Yeah.
The real chickens and the people who dress up in chicken suits.
Yeah.
So.
I don't want to be personal, but why do you dress up in chicken suit?
Why?
Yeah.
Oh, just looking for a bit of extra cash, and
right.
I saw the guy doing it here one night when I was at the pub.
Yeah.
So I walked up to him and
And you took his chicken suit from him?
Yeah, I did. Took him down the back of the lane and gave him a few.
What hours does a chicken work?
He only does 2 hours a day.
2 hours?
But there's two different chickens.
Oh, yeah?
There's myself and another chicken. Basically, I just stand in the street and wave people in.
Yeah.
Jump around in front of cars.
Yeah. Do people talk to you?
A lot of people try to abuse me, yeah. And
yeah?
Try and kick me.
They kick
me.
You?
Yeah. A lot of people see mascots and they think, let's smash them. And I can understand that because I've wanted to do it. Few times when I've seen a few,
so yeah,
it's understandable.
Do you ever fight back or talk back?
I actually haven't had that much problem. The other chicken has.
Yes.
He's actually got a few victims. Last couple of weeks he's got two, so we're pretty happy.
What do you mean he's got circles. Them?
He's clubbed them over the head and kicked them. Anything you have to do.
Chickens don't take things lying down, do
no,
they?
No, we don't.
What do you do the rest of the day?
Rest of the day, I work in a bank.
Oh, of course. That makes sense. I should have known that. And how come you get 2 hours off during the day?
This is my lunch break.
A two-hour lunch break?
Yep.
Bank work must be pretty easy going.
It is pretty easy.
Yeah?
It's just a clerk.
A clerk.
Clerk.
Just a clerk.
A clerk.
You have a fairly important role in a bank, I would have thought.
Not really.
No?
Still doing my course at TAFE, so.
And what is your chicken name?
My chicken name is Bluey.
Bluey?
It's called Bluey because he is a blue chicken.
Right.
But real name's Andrew.
Good talking to you, Andrew Bluey.
I was talking to my partner, but I was wanting to, but he was busy.
He was busy, and you said hello to me.
I did, because you look like him from the back.
Really?
You do. Yeah, I watch front up, and I often say, like, I rang my mum and said, do you know Andrew Upton looks like Dave from the back?
What did she say?
So, he does really, doesn't he?
Your mum's Scottish?
No, she's English.
Oh, that was a Scottish accent you did?
No, that was Northern English.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, yeah.
Is that
so
where you were
nice
born?
To meet you. Yes, it is.
Yeah?
Yes.
I can't see you.
Oh. Hey.
You know my name. What's yours?
It's Carol.
Carol.
Yeah.
You were just ringing David.
I was, yeah.
How is David?
He's very well, yes.
I don't know David, but what does David do?
He works for a childcare agency, Aboriginal childcare.
Aboriginal childcare?
Yeah, he's a field placement officer.
Okay. And what do you do? How do you?
Well, I'm in a similar line of work. I'm a family support worker.
Right.
So I work with young women, sole parents, young women with children.
Did you meet? It sounds as though you might have met professionally. You probably didn't.
Now, I don't know how much I should say here, because David's a very private man, but we actually met 10 years ago and he didn't remember me. We worked in the same agency. And he left, and then I met up with him a few years later, and he introduced himself, and I said, we actually used to work for the same agency. And then we sort of got together then.
And stayed together since?
Yes, yeah.
Do you enjoy what you do?
Yes, I do, yeah. I think it's quite an honour, really, to be involved in people's lives.
Does it make for your life to be balanced, harmonious, peaceful and calm?
I had to get there before I could do the group.
Did you?
I did, yeah.
And how did you get there?
A lot of inner reflection, yeah. I mean, I've just picked up a second-hand book today on EST. You remember that EST thing in the 70s, that EST confrontational therapy? I knew about that way back in the 70s, and I have an interest in, sort of metaphysics and that sort of thing. And through my own journey, I've been able to work where I do now and share these things with women. It's not like we're not a religious or we don't have a particular sort of doctrine in our organisation.
You say you had to get there before you could deal with this. You know, you had to get there yourself and be calm and together, to use a silly word. How much of a journey did you have to take for that?
How untogether were
uphill
you?
Uphill down dale, through floods and a lot of it. Well, I suppose like with time, you learn that a lot of the difficulties that happen in life we create. So as I become more aware of my thoughts, taking responsibility for my thoughts and moving away from blame, then my journey has been quite a lot more peaceful. But I certainly didn't have like a horrendously disadvantaged background, but I've always been a bit of a sensitive sort of person. So, you know, I believe we're all born artists and poets, and then through school that sort of gets taken away or whatever. So my journey's been harder than some and not as hard as others.
Easily upset, easily hurt?
Not now.
But you were.
No, oh yeah. Yeah, well, because I actually think that I could say, well, I'm a poet, but I actually think we're all poets and artists, and some, I've written a piece lately, just recently, and it's called Sisters, Our Brothers Are Not All to Blame, because I think there's a real move towards blaming men for everything that's gone wrong, and I think that we've all sort of been a part of it. Okay. And there was a part that I wrote in there where I said, about taking the scales of injustice and taking each grain of pain to see who's come out the worst. And I don't agree with doing that, but a lot of people get involved with who's to blame, how bad it was, how it's been shocking for women and really, you know, not so bad for men. I don't actually think men have been as ripped off emotionally as what women have.
Why do you think that, by and large, in the wider community, when you say poetry and words like that, people cringe and think that it's not part of their life and it's some kind of soppy, silly?
Well, I think because in order for them to really appreciate it and to experiment with it themselves, they have to get through a few barriers that they've put up, the baby poet had to put up in order to survive. But in order to get back in touch with it themselves, they really have to do some soul searching, so it's easier to, like, wipe it off.
You said earlier that you were interested or had studied metaphysics. What got you interested in that? I mean, in other words, where does all this come from? Where did you get interested in these?
Well, I think that when I was little, I knew that fairies existed. And I knew that that this world as we see it, the physical world, is not all that, you know, that it... all that it seems, and I had a very strong sense from a very young age that there was far more to life than what I was being taught.
What were you being taught? I mean, where did you have
you know, basic sort of reading, writing,
religion?
How to... I had a peripheral sort of Catholic upbringing. I didn't... I made my communion, but it was never confirmed. I never was confirmed. And Catholicism, with no disrespect to Catholicism, doesn't answer a lot of the questions that I have. I actually believe in the evolution of the soul. I don't believe it's a one-off thing that we come here and, you know, get it right or wrong, heaven or hell and full stop. I think it's a process of evolution.
This is the sort of area that's very important and very personal. Do you share this with David?
Oh, very much so. David is Aboriginal, so he has his spiritual beliefs are of the dreaming, and his spirituality is of, it's probably not my place to say what it is, but yeah, we certainly
what
agree.
What you think
with
it is?
What I think it is. I think it's very probably much deeper than mine in many ways, just because of his genetic connection to the land here in Australia. Mm-hmm. But we certainly do share. We don't necessarily share beliefs on about things like karma and reincarnation, and he might not see the evolution of the soul as I see it, but we do certainly share beliefs that go beyond what Christianity portrays. I have the very good fortune to have a teacher. She's a spiritual teacher. And I don't suppose she'd watch this program, but if she did, hello Molly. She's 92. I think, did I say that? She's very old, and she is my role model. And so when I'm doing things, I think, how would Molly handle this? Because she's very... most negative thing I've ever heard her say is he gets a little puffed up sometimes, and I probably say he's really egotistical, but she's a very gracious woman, and so I guess
you aspire to be like her.
I aspire to
in some ways.
To create the strength and harmony that she has in her life. I think that I'm on a journey, like we all are, and I think that part of that journey is... So I pondered the meaning of life at a very young age, and I found it one day sitting on a bar stool. thought, I know what it is. It's to get it together. We just really, it was quite a revelation at the time. So,
were you on the bar stool? Well, you were on the bar stool.
I was on the bar stool with bad posture at the time, and I learned they've got to sit up straight. And that sort of pretty well set it. You know, I needed to, you know, strong back and forward looking, not down.
Yes.
And so the sort of person I've become through that is very, I take very seriously my role in working with the women. I think the role of humour in life is really important, and I hope that I can make a difference.
What's your name?
Nasty Nigel.
Nasty Nigel.
That's my name.
What do you do, Nasty Nigel? Is this your...
This is my close friend, Stephen Sokvari, a.k.a. Hello. Socks.
Socks.
Hi.
Hi. Where are you heading?
Krishna Restaurant.
Yeah. To have lunch?
Have lunch, bit of lunch, yeah, bit of a curry.
No work today?
Done a bit of work today.
Yeah.
Clean the house.
I watched them clean the house. I can vouch for that. I think you need a rest after that. Here in Adelaide?
Yeah, do a bit of DJing. Look, just bought some records.
Good stuff.
It's pretty good. Archie Shep, ladies and gentlemen. And Stan Getz doing Burt Bacharach. That's what you need in your life today, everybody.
That's a wide range. Eclectic
and Frank Sinatra live at the Desert Sands.
Wow.
used and recommended by me.
Uh-huh. You're really late for lunch, huh?
Late for lunch, yeah.
Well, maybe next time we'll catch up.
Love to.
All right.
And what show is this? SBS?
Front Up.
Yeah, I've seen it. It's a fabulous show. Watch it all the time.
Thanks very much.
What's
nice to meet
again?
You. Andrew.
Fantastic.
See you. Excuse us.
Mm-hmm.
We're not going to bite. We're from SBS. We're doing documentary
right.
on people that we meet around Australia at random.
Uh-huh.
Just in the street, going about their way with their flowers. Can you tell us where the flowers are, or what the flowers are destined for?
Oh, they're just for a friend that I'm popping in to see to have a coffee with. It's nice
Nothing
to
special.
Take. No, nice to take a friend something special.
Is this a regular friend? I mean, a friend? Or?
No, not really. It's just she's been through an illness recently, so...
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Right.
She's back at work now.
Right. What does she do? Or what do you do?
I'm a financial advisor.
Right. For a bank or...
No, an independent company.
You have day off or...
No,
lunch?
No. It's just between appointments.
Between appointments?
Yes.
Do you have a background in financial advice, or
yes,
is it something you're trained for? Or?
Well, both, basically. I've been in the industry for 12 years.
It's a man's world, most people think.
Oh, yes.
Is it?
I've been called he a lot.
What's your first name?
Christine.
Christine, well...
So you don't say Christine and it's Chris.
Yes.
They assume you're a male.
Yeah, I see. But does it ever make a difference to you? Do you find it creates borders...
Not at all. I do believe that women have to be better in this industry because it is male orientated. So you've got to prove yourself. I think if you're good and you've got goals to aim towards, it doesn't really matter.
You don't feel that you've been held back?
No, not at all.
To what extent do you have a core clientele that forms the bulk of your business wherever you go?
It's basically people that want to get ahead. A lot of people think that they have to be wealthy to be investors, but you have to be an investor to be wealthy.
Is that what you tell them?
No, that's what I've learned throughout the years. I mean, people think that to go and see a financial advisor that they need to have some money. They don't have to have any money at all. It's just exploring your options and showing people what's available to them.
Are there any downsides to it?
Long hours. Not getting home until 11 o'clock at night. Yeah.
That long?
Yeah. But it's not like that every day.
Sure.
I mean, sometimes you get home a little bit earlier. Sometimes you leave a little bit later in the morning. There are compensations. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, being your own boss is great as well. I could not ever imagine being tied to a desk somewhere.
Mm. Mm. Do you have a partner?
Yes, I do.
And does it make life difficult?
Well, he's studying at the moment, so he's taking care of the house and all of those types of things, and makes my breakfast, gets my lunch ready for me, has my dinner on the table when I get home. So it's a help, yeah.
That's fairly well chosen.
Mm.
How long have you known Mr... What's his first name?
Michael.
How long have you
known him? About 18 months.
Right. Mm. It's, did you know that he was going to be so supportive?
No. It's a two-way thing that I'm supporting him while he studies.
Sure.
If he didn't meet me, he wouldn't be studying at the moment.
Yeah.
So he's being able to fulfil what he wants to do, so that obviously it's going to benefit his future.
How did you meet him?
Through work, through a seminar that I did.
And he was one of the students there?
It's getting a bit personal, isn't it? I did a seminar for a large corporation. He showed me around.
And then he obviously followed it up.
Yes, he did.
Did you know that he would?
No, not at all. He made some poor excuse about looking at his superannuation.
It was a poor excuse?
Yes, it was.
He still doesn't have one.
Oh, yes, he has one.
He does.
Yes, he does, yes.
So you did.
I've invested his money wisely.